Rolling, rolling, rolling.
Hello, welcome to Soil the Word Mirror. I'm your hostess, Betty St. Laveau. On this show, we discuss film, film definitions, film history, and then we go straight into the movies. Today, I have a list before we go into our two movies, and it's called, I've got the list of love goddesses for the guys, and then on the back of here, I have for the gals, love God. So let's start off with what I deem are love goddesses. Now, everyone out there has their own definition. I tried to stick with people who are still alive. A few of them aren't, but I just had to narrow it down because there's so many in our Hollywood pantheon that, my goodness, we'd be here all night, right? So let's start off the list. Viola Davis, Vanessa Williams, Sonia Braga, Elizabeth Ashley, Carol Baker, Gina Gershon, Eva Mendes, Jessica Alba, Margot Robbie, Selma Hayek, Jennifer Lopez, Taraji P. Henson, Rita Hayworth, Ava Gardner, Joan Chen, Ali Lauda, Pam Grier, Sophia Loren, Michelle Rodriguez, Kirsten Stewart, Halle Berry, Sharon Stone, Lana Turner, Kim Rava, Lola Giuliani, I think I have Rita here twice, of course, Kate Beckinsale, Edie Falco, Mila Kunis, and Liz Taylor. That's a good start, I think. Okay, so that's for us gals. Now, for you guys, that was for you guys, this for you gals, but, you know, you can always mix it up, so whatever. So here's the guy list, movie gods. Timothy Oliphant, Benicio del Toro, Daniel Craig, Ezra Morales, Wesley Snipes, Russell Crowe, Timothy Dalton, Chris Pine, Idris Elba, Mr. Downey, Chow Yun-Fat, Rob Lowe, Will Smith, Peter Gallagher, Chris Hemsworth, Tony Leung, Russell Wong, Robbie Benson, Jason Bateman, Jerry O'Connor, Jacob Pitts, and Richard Burton, Richard Harris, and Charlton Heston. I think that starts us off just fine. Okay, so now we're going to go into the movies. Today I decided that, well, love is a battlefield, and what two movies can illustrate the battlefield of love or the battlefield at all, as in Conan the Barbarian and Valley of the Dolls. So let's start off with Conan, I think. Okay, so years ago I read in Julia's Phillips book there, You'll Never Eat Lunch in This Town Again, and it's about her rise and fall in Hollywood. And she described certain vignettes of different people who worked in the business, and John Millis, who directed and co-wrote with Oliver Stone, well, he co-wrote with Oliver Stone Conan, but he directed it. He used to like to shoot guns in the backyard. And so she just kind of commented on the male testosterone worldview that exists in Hollywood back when the new wave of directors were coming in. So I found it very interesting, and I've always forgotten that Oliver Stone co-wrote the script, because Mr. Stone seems like kind of the intellectual, not that he's not a real dude, but I just never considered that he co-wrote this with Mr. Millius. Okay, so let's backtrack to when I'm sitting down watching it, okay, in Versailles, and I really liked it. I loved the editing, I loved the scenery, I loved the costumes, I loved Arnold, because when I was 6 years old, a little bit older than that, it must have been 11 or 12, Pumping Iron came out, and I remember seeing the trailers at the drive-in and really wanting to watch the movie, not knowing that I thought Arnold was cute, because William Shatner was more my type when I was a little kid. But over the years, I grew fascinated with his rise in Hollywood in the entertainment business. When I was six, a little kid, I had watched Don't Make Waves with Tony Curtis, Sharon Tate, and Dave Draper, who back then was the, I don't know, I'm pretty sure he made Mr. Universe, but he was the bodybuilder back in the day. So I'd always, as a little kid, had kept my eye on that. So looking at Arnold and Conan, I love the whole, in the pit there, you know, his, yes, I've won and I'm the man, and the colonization that happened back in Sumeria, Russia, Scythia, back in the day, it happened all over the world, the way his village had been attacked. I loved to see his transition from being younger to honing his warrior stance to being a free man and then becoming a warrior. And the movie does not touch on the fact that later Conan becomes a king. He's a character based on Robert E. Howard's book. So he sacrifices love, he sacrifices his body, he sacrifices, he's had to sacrifice his whole way of life to become who he is. And I like the fact that back when this movie was made, the geopolitical stance in this country, Reagan era, was the strong man. And the movie reflected the times back then. So it was a little bit of nostalgia kicking in for me. Now, the beginning starts off in the time when the oceans drank Atlantis. There was an age of dreamed of. These are great opening credits. You see the fire making the sword, his dad forging the steel. The mom is gorgeous. The little child looks like little Arnold. It's a tale of sorrow, the wheel of pain. These are iconic images in this movie. Now, I loved comic books as a little girl, but I did not read Conan. He scared me, okay? I just wasn't into the whole sword wielding. I sort of wanted to see the, you know, X-Men fly around. But as I become older, I can appreciate the warrior honed by adversity and tenacity. All right, so that might be it for that one. Oh, okay, so I just want to touch on this also. William Smith, who played Arnold's dad, he could speak five languages. He was a excellent boxer, and he played the bad guy, the Soviet bad guy in Red Dawn that Patrick Swayze killed at the end. His Russian was real, and thank you, Robert Biga, on YouTube. He helped me out with that fact. Also, for quite a few years, I had a picture in my office at Yestermorrow of the new Conan movie. I will never watch it. I hear it's like kaputz, okay? Not good, all right? So sometimes movies, the remakes are cheesy. It's, go see the remake if you want. I wouldn't advise it. I'm not probably ever going to watch it unless I catch it off the cuff. Now, when we see Conan in that pit, the music's booming up, that guy with that teeth, right? Looks really scary. There are many stories about how the octagon for MMA UFC was conceived and built. Several people take credit for it. John Milius takes credit for it, and he says that for the fight scene, he wanted something different besides a boxing ring, or he didn't want anything round, and he didn't want anything square, right? So I did think that he probably did create the, and I'm sure he was in on it, but when you look at the movie, the dang thing doesn't look like it's an octagon at all. I'm sorry, you see the stone walls. I checked it out last night and today. You see the stone walls, and at one point they look rounded, and then at another point it kind of looks boxy square, but you never really see the whole pit and the octagon. It's like John Travolta said when they were filming Saturday Night Fever. He said to the director, "You got to get my legs." And the director goes, "You're acting." And Mr. Travolta goes, "It's a movie about dancing. You got my legs." So I wish that they had just filmed the entire Octagon, basically what they did focus on was the fighting and Arnold, who looked fantastic. They edited it really quickly, but he was the focus in those scenes. So I really wished we could see the actual Octagon. Maybe it's just version I was watching. All right, so yes, this film, it's all about reveal. Everything's peaceful, quiet in the village. All of a sudden, the horsemen come out. Arnold, you know, he's just trying to live by his wits, and all of a sudden, he has these adventures. So please check it out. It's a gem. No CGI, I think it's called. It's great. All right, so our next movie might not look like it's related to Conan the Barbarian, but it is, and it's called Valley of the Dolls. And it starred Barbara Pawkins, Sharon Tate, Patty Duke, Lee Grant, Martin Milne, a couple other people, Susan Hayward. Pardon me, Susan. Okay. This, talk about love as a battlefield. These dames are fighting it out on the biggest arena in the world for a woman, where the goddess ambition rules, New York City. Okay, so I want to say this right now. The movie, not good. The book is much better. At 12, I'm watching a movie with my sisters. We're staying up late. We loved it, okay? So when you're a little kid, this movie's awesome. And I'm feeling a sense of deja vu because I hope that I just didn't review this movie, but it really fits in with the fact that as a warrior, you have to keep your back straight, your chin up, no matter if your friends betray you, if your family betrays you, you're going for the gold. And to quote Jackie Suzanne, who wrote the book, when you're aiming for Mount Everest, you look at the top. You don't see all the steps that you have to go through because as long as you keep your eyes on the top, you're going to get there. Unfortunately, our ladies learn that just because you climb that mountain of ambition doesn't mean that you're going to be happy, okay? So the movie is a chopped up mess. It's horrible. Jackie Suzanne walked out. I don't blame her one bit. Just not even funny. Do I have my statistics for this? I don't have how much it made. I wish I did. It's not sitting in front of me. But at any rate, the book stayed at the top of the bestseller list for weeks and weeks. Her next three books did the same thing. She's one of the biggest selling authors of all time. And the novel, Valley of the Dolls, I think 31 million copies have been sold as of 2016. Please check out the book. The book's a gem. Because of Jackie Suzanne, Sidney Sheldon, who is actually a fairly decent TV producer, but Sidney Sheldon, Harold Robbins, and who's the other person? They all became best-selling authors because of the Jackie Suzanne formula. And I know these guys, Sidney Sheldon, Harold Robbins, who's the other guy? Not Ira Levin, that's a different genre. But these men were able to produce the same kind of what they call schlock that Jackie did. Now, the critics do not like books like these, but the public does. So the book is even much grittier than the movie. Ann Wells is a Yankee lass who leaves Massachusetts behind her. Neely O'Hara is a hard-bitten kid who raised in vaudeville and theater and will let nothing stand in her way. And then there's our lovely Jennifer, who is simply a showgirl, and everyone just wants to use her for her face and her body. All right, so these three gals, they become friends, but there's tension, heartache, and tragedy along the way. So I'm basically shilling for the book today. Please read the book. You'll love it. You can find it probably at the book sale down the street or any flea market. You can order it. It's great. It's wonderful. And one of the reasons why we have the pop culture we do today is because of Miss Suzanne, who was simply a great, fantastic writer, and we happen to share the same birthday. Voila. All right, so, Mario Puzo was the other author I wanted to throw in there along with Mr. Robbins and Mr. Sheldon, because that book, The Godfather, that was just high-class porn. I'm glad the movie, now there's a case where the movie much better than the book. The book had these ludicrous scenes and some medical information that I know that Mr. Puzo created and made up, and never so shocking. But when you read Jackie Suzanne's novels, you can almost believe what she's talking about. Like, well, there may be a couple of outlandish things, and Once Is Not Enough. But other than that, a lot of pulp fiction writing, which is considered literature today because in America that is who we are. In Europe, Africa, and Asia, there are huge monuments and beautiful buildings, Middle East. But here, we've made our own culture, and so it's books and movies like these that are sort of our monuments. It doesn't mean that they're great monuments. They can be flawed, but they're all monuments. And Jackie Suzanne contributed to our pop culture, as did Mr. John Milius. All right. I think that that's it for me today. I'm your hostess, Betty St. Laveau. You've been watching Celluloid Mirror here at Orca. I want to thank my crew here today and Gendron Building for its continued support, St. Laveau Consultations for taking the day off, and my first film professor, Ochizanya Clarich Sharon Ardella Paris Warfield, who helped me articulate and elucidate on the silver screen. Until next time, babies, stay away from those bad movies. Ciao.